The following program is classified as PG. It is not suitable for viewing by persons under 15 years of age without guidance from a parent or guardian. This is an opinion-based program. Viewer discretion is advised.
Good evening, I'm Mahieash Johnney. It's 7 o'clock and this is the State of the Nation.
Tonight, the economic nightmare. Queues, queues, queues everywhere. Sri Lanka has fallen to a level never seen before in modern times. After for 73 years failing to take traction of its economy, now seems to be at the tail end of a disaster that's slowly taking the worst form day by day.
අපි දන්නවා මේවායින් සමහර විට විවිධ ප්‍රතිවිපාක ජන ජීවිතේ ලැබෙන්න තිබුණත් දිගු කාලීන ස්ථායිභාවය රැක ගැනීම සඳහා මහා බැංකුව ඒ තීරණ අරන් තිබේ.
Everyone seems to be for him or herself rather than thinking about the common good. The president urges a troubled nation to be cautious and support this national cause.
අධෛර්යමත් නොවි මේ අර්බුදකාරී තත්ත්වෙන් ගොඩ එමට ජාතියක් වශයෙන් එක්වන ලෙස ඔබ සියලු දෙනාගෙන් ඉල්ලා සිටිනවා.
Somebody wants to be president. Is it you? Are you? It's you, isn't it? The opportunistic opposition, instead of creating a voice against the suffering, the hardships, the misery and distress, the jokers are calling for a presidential poll after losing one in record numbers. A Chinese silence. The big brother of Asia seems to have vouched for a silent approach. At the same time, Sri Lanka undergoes these current economic woes. Why? Is it because of the finance minister's pro-West stance? Or did Big Brother get upset about the fertilizer case?
I think you're right. He seemed to be drifting away from China. It's not a wise thing.
Tonight, we'll dive deep into this relationship and the possible beacon of hope. While Sri Lanka is fighting for forex battle to find more dollars, what's happening to the port city is set up to solve this very same issue.
It's been dubbed Sri Lanka's new Dubai.
Colombo Port City, being built on land reclaimed from the sea, will massively boost its economy.
The latest on this story and much more next on State of the Nation.
It's Sunday, the 20th of March, 2022. Good evening. This is the State of the Nation, where we invite you to know your nation to know the world. Well, tonight our entire focus is on Sri Lanka's economic woes. Now, throughout the week, we brought you special reports to keep you up to date on the conversation surrounding Sri Lanka's economy, the problems, the solutions and whatnot. Now, tonight, we will get you the side that you have not explored or portrayed in the mainstream media and give you a better understanding of what and where things are right now. But first, now, what would he do when an enslaver feels like the slave is trying to free himself from the clutches he has masterfully set? First, he'll use scare tactics to reinstill fear in the slave's mind and heart. Will create a doom and gloom scenario throughout, showcasing that if this action is not taken, things will be callous and rough for the slave.
You have to talk with the international financial institutions, the international monetary agencies. You have to ask for a fresh financial assistance program.
ආයෝජකයන්ට කතා කරන්න යම් කිසි අපිට ඒ අවස්ථාවක් සලසන්න ජාත්‍යන්තර මූල්‍ය අරමුදල අවශ්‍ය වෙනවා.
We must go to the IMF, negotiate with the IMF that we have sufficient money for the next 2 years.
IMF loan නැතුව අපි මේකෙන් බේරෙන්න බෑ.
එකම විකල්පයයි තිබෙන්නේ ඒක තමයි ජාත්‍යන්තර මූල්‍ය අරමුදලට යන්නේ.
Now, if that fails, then the enslaver will send his brigade of behind cases who will glorify the master and create a picture in the mind of the slave. How much they want the master. The master is the only solution and answer.
බිස්නස් ප්ලෑන් එකක් නැතුව IMF ගිහිල්ලා වැඩකුත් නැහැ. ක්ෂණික ක්‍රියාමාර්ගය අපි ණය ගෙවීම වහාම පෙරසූදානම් සාකච්ඡාවට එළවිලා ණය ගෙවීම කල් දානවා කියන බව ප්‍රතිව්‍යුහගත කරනවා කියන බවට අපි දැම්මම පටන් ගන්නවා.
Perhaps a strategic mistake to expect one country to bail you out and provide these kinds of regulatory tax concessions that are not necessarily optimal for the economy. In the hope that they will result in a reciprocative assistance which has not materialized in Sri Lanka's case.
මේ අවස්ථාවේදී දුනත් ඒ හැර වෙනත් විකල්පයක් නැහැ ලංකාවට.
මුදල් අමාත්‍යවරයා සහ භාණ්ඩාගාර ලේකම්තුමා සහ මහ බැංකු අධිපතිවරයා අන්තර්ජාතික මූල්‍ය අරමුදලට ලිපියකින් ආරාධනා කරන්න ඕනේ අපිට මේ සහයෝගය ලබා දෙන්න කියලා.
But I can tell you we stand ready to discuss all options for Sri Lanka.
And when that's not working, the master will ramp up the pressure via his agents to sing that one song. Go to the IMF, go to the IMF, until you are broken and down in depths and starts to believe that it's the only way. Ladies and gentlemen, Sri Lanka is right now at that point. The current nationalistic government, which came to power on the promise of securing Sri Lanka and its interests from Western investments, have now opted to reverse its policies to cater to the current situation. So despite me trying to sound that the decision by the Finance Minister Basil Rajapaksa to proceed with IMF support, despite many in the current government denying that they'll ever reverse their economic stance or borrow from these types of financial agencies, the situation at hand, owing to the COVID pandemic, has dictated the term, where it has cornered us to the point where there are no other options. At least that's how it looks like. As I tell you all the time, there are two sides to every story. Going to the IMF has its pros and cons too.
So IMF will always come as a facilitator. They are really good in terms of fiscal reforms. Sometimes front-loaded, so some countries have got into some amount of stress because of agreeing on all these conditions. But if you look at the past, 30 years ago, they used to give us a policy and we would implement, but from that to now, there's a good two-way conversation. So it's up to us to use our intellect and negotiate something good for the country.
But then I ask the simple question, okay, when the IMF came during the last regime, it was to fix our economy. It was to create economic growth. It was to fix our trade balance. What did we fix? We fixed the primary account in the budget, which is basically revenue minus the current expenditure. Mm-hmm. And he said, look, you see, we balanced the budget. So what? What did you get out of it? Did it make a difference to people?
True.
No. I think, you know, the way to look at this is there's a lot of crap going on. That these arguments are being basically manipulated, manufactured to serve a particular agenda.
Well, Sri Lanka is indeed in a crisis that has been 73 years in the making. However, what matters is what are we doing right now to solve the problems? That's not creating a fresh set of issues for the near future. Our action cannot be as such. We get out from one pit to fall for several more. Certain options will always seem like the only solution because our thinking is flawed, as we are frustrated because of the crisis we are facing right now. People are angry because of the fuel queues. People are angry because of the gas queues. People are angry because of the power cuts. However, anger is a short-lived emotion. So if our action is based on that short-lived emotion to change that frown to a smile, then the resulting smile will be short-lived too, just like the solution. Today, mainstream media's prime time is dedicated to showcasing those cues, the one that is a clear result of global events. Sri Lankans didn't create COVID, it came from China. Sri Lankans didn't request to go to NATO to anger Russia, which resulted in regional unrest. Ukraine did, and that escalated to a global war. Sri Lankans didn't cut oil productions to jack up the prices. The oil cartels did due to the conflict in Ukraine. Even though we didn't do any of that, we're going through its repercussions. That's what happens when you are part of the global community. However, Sri Lankans did mismanage the economy for 73 years. Sri Lankans did not do proper planning to meet an economic crisis at the onset of the pandemic. And Sri Lankans did not understand the fluctuating world market trends to prepare their people for the impending crisis. If the leaders of this country are taking long-term decisions based on the short-term anger of a selfish and self-centered idiot in a fuel queue, who got a chance to utter some creative lines to a camera so that he can boast to his friends and family to watch the news because he's on it. If decisions are based on TikTok videos created by keyboard heroes who have no experience whatsoever about an economic crisis, no understands the basics of managing a household, or better yet, doesn't even know how to make their own bed after waking up in the morning, yet has the audacity to dictate how this country should be governed. And if decisions are made based on comments passed on by self-proclaimed economic pundits who haven't even lived enough to have experienced a real on-the-ground financial crisis that has hit this nation, and yet reads a book written by a foreigner who his or her economic teacher recommended, and then comes on and screams on television or on social media or any platform for that matter he or she can muster to get into and tell everybody that it's the only solution, or if decisions are taken based on views expressed by think tanks who have special interests, mainly because they're funded by international organizations who want them to sing the IMF song. And if decisions are made based on how or what is said on social media, then Sri Lanka has already lost the war. True leaders of the world were not made because they took popular decisions that are comfortable for all in the short term. True leaders were made because they saw a better world for their people and had the eye on the prize beyond the horizon and inspired the rest of his people to go there. We saw that leadership back in 2005 when an unknown fisheries minister told the nation that yes, we can win a war that was told unwinnable. That leadership was seen back in 1965 in the world when a country was told that they were going to suffer enormously after detaching from their mainland, but later became one of the strongest economies in the world, called Singapore. We've seen that leadership back in World War II, when the whole world was in the clutches of a ruthless dictator called Hitler. It didn't seem like there was a win on the other side. But a man named Churchill rallied the British people and the rest of the people in the world, and he led his country and the world from a brink of defeat to victory. We have to stand as one nation in a crisis and work together to get out of it. The government is not an institution sitting on a cloud. The government is us. We created it. So blaming the government is like blaming ourselves. Instead of playing the blame game, let's play the winning game. The game that lets Sri Lanka win. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the State of the Nation. Yes, we all are undergoing severe hardships these days. With gas to fuel to medicine to power cuts, everything seems to be in disarray. Now, people are frustrated, angry, and screaming at the government, asking them to give them everything the same way before the pandemic. But what most don't realize is we cannot. See, during the past 2 years, Sri Lanka had a sweet ride. Unfortunately, the government didn't take the necessary steps in curtailing unnecessary imports that would have saved a lot of money, purely because the government didn't want to burn the people back then. When people around the world were losing their jobs, countries were plunging into economic crisis, businesses were getting shut down, and when families were finding it difficult to put food on the table around the world, here in Sri Lanka, we were whisking through because our government did everything to ensure that our people get to enjoy life with minimum disruption. Now, at that point, the most significant talk of the town, if you can remember, was lockdowns. The opposition couldn't make up their mind about lockdowns. At one point, they say, close the country. The very next moment, open the country. You will remember all that drama, right? But what was not on people's radar was the economic hardships we would experience if we were not careful. Certain restrictions were a must, but Sri Lanka didn't adhere to them. And now the time has come to settle our dues to the devil.
Some of the key areas that we should have focused on, also should have maybe put more focus on, I think we didn't manage to do that, so we have to adjust for those situations, especially the fuel crisis, the electricity, the power generation, the gas supply. Those things are, certain things are beyond our control.
At least now, what people need to understand is that screaming on the road, providing very creative one-liners when a camera passes by, or protesting left, right and center is not going to make oil magically appear in our sheds. Our dollar starts to fall into our coffers. Our gas starts to ooze from the ground. The events of the world are affecting us. And this is the new reality we have to face as a nation and face it collectively. Whilst the opposition has done everything to capitalize on this opportunity, hoping to get back into power riding this wave, the president, after missing in the public eye for many weeks, addressed a troubled nation and called for understanding and rational behavior.
අපි ඉතිහාසයේ ඕනෑ තරම් අවස්ථාවල වැටිලා නැගිටපු ජාතියක්. විදේශ ආක්‍රමණවලට, මහා සාගතවලට, ස්වාභාවික විපත්වලට, ත්‍රස්තවාදී උවදුරුවලට අපි මුහුණ දීලා ආපසු නැගිටලා තියෙනවා. පසුගිය කොරෝනා වසංගතයට අපි මුහුණ දුන් ආකාරය ජාත්‍යන්තර ආයතනවල පවා ප්‍රශංසාවට ලක් වුණා. විසඳුම් ක්‍රියාත්මක කිරීමේදී යම් කාලයක් අපට දුෂ්කරතාවලට මුහුණ දෙන්නට වෙන බව අපි සියලු දෙනාම වටහා ගත යුතුයි. ඒ නිසා අධෛර්යමත් නොවි මේ අර්බුදකාරී තත්ත්වෙන් ගොඩ එමට ජාතියක් වශයෙන් එක්වන ලෙස ඔබ සියලු දෙනාගෙන්ම ඉල්ලා සිටිමි.
Despite my argument that the people of this country need to act more diligently and intelligently, I also have a beef with the government. As I said last week, their PR game in communicating with the people is pathetic. At a time of crisis, what's needed is clarity. Clarity on understanding where we are right now. No, don't expect people to find it by themselves or act rationally, especially when you can't be bothered to tell them. They didn't elect leaders or bring in governments to power to find it by themselves. They want their trusted leaders to tell them what is happening, what's going on. And once that's made known, the people also need to know what's the plan to get out of it. Yes, that too needs to be communicated very clearly. Not just once a week, in my opinion, at least 24/7. It's the responsibility of the government information people to keep telling the nation what they are doing to solve the problems at hand, an interactive dialogue with its citizens. Minister, no fuel, and long queues at petrol stations. Well, the minister can say, don't worry, currently we have a shortage of dollars. Still, we are working on it, speaking to the relevant officials to get that sorted out. I believe it will be solved by tomorrow evening. Perhaps then, if those things were communicated to the people, then a guy who had enough petrol to last for 2 or 3 days would say, okay, if things are going to be okay in a couple of days, then I don't have to be part of this panic buying spree. If the government is for the people, if the government is by the people, then why don't you also tell the people what you are doing to improve their lives? Well, let's understand the current government's thinking. For that, I'm now joined by the State Minister of Urban Development, Waste Disposal and Community Cleanliness, Dr. Nalaka Gudayeva. Dr. Gudayeva, good to see you always. Minister, it seems that you all have run out of options and are even going to the point You are sacrificing the very economic stance that brought you to power. I'm talking about this IMF solution. Is that the only option you all have right now for this crisis?
Mahesh, I don't think there is any contradiction with the economic policies that we have put forward. The economic circumstances have changed over the last 2 years because of this global corona pandemic. The situation that arose is something that was unanticipated. So that has led to a huge dollar crisis, as His Excellency President himself has publicly acknowledged. So there is no denial of that fact. We have a serious foreign currency problem at the moment. And when you try to resolve that, one of the biggest problems that we are having is continuous debt payments that we have to pay every year. For example, if you take 2022, we have something like $7 billion to be paid, out of which about $1 billion has to be paid somewhere in June, July. Whilst we are having an issue of even buying our essential commodities. So in order to find a solution for that, we have to establish our credentials with the global lender community also. In that, IMF will definitely help. And that's the reason we are going to IMF, so it's not a major shift from the policies.
Well, Minister, we need more than around $4 to $5 billion of a cash injection right now to calm things with regard to our economy. Now, IMF is not going to bring that anytime soon because the negotiations are going to take time. So why is the government not focusing on getting bilateral support from friendly nations that have always helped us, like India and China? We see that you guys are actively working with India, but you have omitted China. Why is that? Don't you think that China can help us out of this crisis right now?
I don't think government is looking at IMF as the only solution. That cannot be, as you very correctly said, Mahesh, because it will take time. It's a program. But it will help the credibility of the government when you negotiate with the other parties who are involved in this picture. That's the reason why we are going to IMF. Bilateral discussions, particularly with overseas loans and also short-term lending requirements, discussions are already underway, as you very correctly said. Finance Minister went to India. There's a discussion that was going on. 1 billion credit line has already been agreed. I'm sure the finance team who are handling this economic situation must be talking to China as well. I can't comment on that because I'm not directly involved in that. But obviously that has to be done. We have to talk to all our friends.
All right, I understand. Minister, I also hear through the grapevine that the government will renegotiate the MCC grant by America. Is there any truth to that?
Not to our knowledge, because the only way that I can get to know about that is if there's a discussion in the group meeting, because I'm not a member of the cabinet. But even if there was a discussion in cabinet, by this time, that would have been openly discussed. So to my knowledge, there's no such discussion at the moment. But I can only comment based on our current knowledge.
Understand. But what is your economic outlook, Minister, for Sri Lanka in the next few months? When is this crisis going to end?
See, if you look at the economic situation compared to last year, this year will be a better year. If you look at the last 2 years, that was disastrous. If you look at the whole problem, how this situation got developed was every year. For the last couple of years, there was always a gap of about $8 million to $10 million, a trade gap in our country. Let's say your exports are only 10 to 12 billion and your imports are 20 to 22 billion. There's that gap always. Even in 2022, the prediction is there'll be about $10 billion US dollar gap. How did you bridge that gap in the previous years? That was a hand-to-mouth solution. The tourism and foreign remittances together gave us about $10 billion. So you essentially cover that loss, but in order to pay debts and other development requirement, you still have to borrow. So it was not a good situation at all. So this year, I think the way I understand is government is looking at reducing this gap. For example, I think even at President Gotabaya Rajapaksa's address to the nation, he mentioned they're hoping that the exports will grow by about another $1 billion, from $12 billion to $13 billion, and I think the expectation is to bring the import bill also by about another $2 billion. And there's expectation that tourism and the IT sector, the services, and also the foreign remittances will also grow by about another 10 billion. So with these things, we can reasonably expect this year there won't be a drop in foreign currency level. In fact, at least 2 billion foreign reserves increase we can expect this year. But this is not good enough. As you very correctly asked, Mahesh, you can't look at 1 year. You have to look at long term. I mean, you can't look at, you have to look beyond this government. I mean, we are talking of a nation at the end of the day. So in that scenario, we have to somehow increase our methods of earning foreign currency. What are those methods? One is exports. Exports is still at 12 billion. I think something that we must be ashamed of as a nation. You can't blame any government for that. After 73 years since independence, having only 12 billion exports is something is terribly wrong in our system. This should have been at least 20 billion in my opinion by now. So a lot of things we have missed out. So we have to work at these issues and find out why the exports are not growing. Why are we not giving sufficient facilities to FDIs? Are we not giving sufficient facilities to these exporters? Are we not looking at new market opportunities? For example, agriculture sector. If you take a smaller country like Netherlands, which is much smaller than us, the agriculture is the main export. Now, Sri Lanka, agriculture, we are talking self-sufficiency, but we are not into exports at all, very marginally. And also, IT sector, foreign remittances, the remittances, then tourism. These are areas that we have to very actively work with during the next 2-3 years and work towards that. So that's the only way. The long-term solution is to increase revenue from foreign currency sources.
Hopefully. Well, thank you very much, State Minister of Urban Development, Dr. Nalaka Gurahewa. As always, it's a pleasure to see you, sir. Thank you. Let's take a short commercial break. On the other side, we will talk about someone's aspirations of becoming president. We'll be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the State of the Nation. Last Tuesday, the opposition took to the streets to protest against the current issues faced by the people. Or at least, that's what they say they were going to do. Okay, so let's break this down. Is it the right of the opposition to protest, even though this crisis is not something that this government created and is just reacting to global events? Absolutely yes. It's their God-given right to protest. So if they are protesting, what should they ask for? Sort out the economic crisis, solve the distribution delays, solve the debt matter, find the dollars. Also, if they really want to be productive for the country and give a damn about the people, they could come up with several economic proposals to solve this mess. But what did they do and say?
අනිවාර්යෙන් රජයේ එළවණකම් අපි මේ ගමන ගෙනියනවා
මැද පෙර දිග රටවල් තුනක් සමගි ජන බලවේග අපේ ආණ්ඩුවකට පොරොන්දු වෙලා තියෙනවා වසර දෙකකට අඛණ්ඩව එකවරම මුදල් ගෙවීමක් නැතුව වසර දෙකකට පසුව මුදල් ගෙවීම යටතේ අපේ රටට ඉන්ධන ලබා දෙන්න
The problem with this is very daring. When these goons claim that they will sort out the economic matter and provide solutions to a crisis, they need to showcase a track record of stellar performance in the past, right? Look at these jokers. Despite speaking as if they were never in power, these clowns were the ones running the nation from 2015 to 2019, a time period that we never experienced any global issue whatsoever. Yes, this guy who calls himself an economic guru, he was the state minister of national policies and economic affairs. And this clown was the state minister of finance. So let's take a look at their fantastic, absolutely stellar, golden brains hard at work.
දැන් ඔබතුමා ලගේ බොක්ක ටික රත් වෙයි. දැන් මෙහෙම එක දැක්කහම මොකද අපි ඔක්කොම දැන් ලක්ෂ 4 හමාර ගානේ ණය කියන එක ඔළුවේ මතක තියාගන්න.
ශ්‍රී ලංකා මහ බැංකු වාර්තා අනුව 2017 වර්ෂයේ නොවැම්බර් 30 වන දිනට ගෙවිය යුතු මුළු ණය ශේෂය රුපියල් ට්‍රිලියන 10.3ක් බව දැක්වෙනවා.
The business environment in Sri Lanka has not been very positive for quite a long time. The business community has not been particularly comfortable with this coalition government. Business sentiment has been very weak. Investment has not been particularly strong in terms of private investment.
And what about the guy who wants to lead this nation, replace the current president? Because if he comes to power, oil is going to ooze from the ground, perhaps from goldfish. Dollars are going to rain from the sky, and every person in this country is going to be flourishing in wealth. So how was the wannabe president's track record when he was in power?
මගේ කී දෙනෙකුට සභාපති කන් දෙනවද මගේ කී දෙනෙකුට නිලධර දෙනවද එහෙම ඩීල් දේශපාලනය සමගි ජන බලවේගයේ කරන්නේ නැහැ
නියුමත් දෙන්නම් මේව වෙන්නේ නැහැ ළමයෝ හරි නියුමත් දෙන්නම් මගේ අමාත්‍යංශය රස්සාවක් දෙන්නම් හරි ඔගොල්ලෝ මම මේ කියන්නේ ඒ අමාත්‍යංශය අමතියා උඹේව පුරවනවා මගේව පුරවනවා ඉගෙන ගන්න ඕක හරිද
What I need to tell is that stop believing a bunch of clowns who have a proven track record of ruining a good thing. Instead, try to be patient enough to trust a group who've delivered time and time after for this nation. Yes, the queues are irritating, uncomfortable, annoying, and frustrating. The power cuts are fudged up. But buddy, just because we live on an island doesn't mean global events doesn't affect us. It does. And understanding it and acting rationally is the only way forward. However, suppose this government fails to respond to these clowns and take control of the narrative, in that case, this country will indeed be theirs again. The opposition came to the goldfish and screamed, Gota, go home. And in the end, Gota went back to work and the opposition went home. All right, with me now is the State Minister of Fisheries, Kanchan Vijayasekara. Thank you very much, Minister, for your time. I appreciate it. Sir, back when the good governance joke was in power, the Mahinda Sulanga was the fact that toppled that joke of a government. Now, it seems like the tables have turned. Have you guys forgotten the people's pain because we are seeing lackluster approach by this government in order to solve the issue? Is that why the opposition is gaining traction?
No, of course we haven't forgotten why we were elected into power. Of course we have to understand that there is a global crisis and we are also facing consequences of that. And of course we do apologize and regret the fact that we have not been able to manage the supply chains appropriately. And we will make sure that supply chains are back in order. People will have uninterrupted electricity, gas, diesel, other fuel, and we would make things right for them.
I understand that Minister, now the opposition leader wants an immediate presidential election. He screamed at the recent protest. Has this government come to a point where you can't solve the problems? Have you run out of solutions?
No, I think going by the past experience as well, even President Rajapaksa faced so many of those obstacles, challenges, but we never ran away from those challenges. And I'm sure President Gotabaya Rajapaksa has faced similar challenges before and is prepared to face any of the challenges. And we will see out the the next 3 years, and also the people will have the right to decide who they want to elect in the next election. So there is no election that will be held before the next 3 years.
Well, let's hope for the best. All right, State Minister of Fisheries Kanchan Vijayasekara, thank you very much, sir. Time for another short commercial break. On the other side, I want to know why China is so silent in all this mess. Be right back. Welcome back, everyone, to the State of the Nation. Now, one of the most significant missing pieces of this economic puzzle is China. Where is China? Usually, as I've told you on many occasions, China has been a strong supporter of Sri Lanka for many years. Now, from the onset of Prime Minister Sirimao Bandaranaike's time to current President Gotabaya Rajapaksa, China has been a strong ally of Sri Lanka. They fought for us on the global stage, helped us economically, and more so, they've stood by this country through thick and thin. As I try to dig deep into finding what's going on, many intellectuals and academics I've spoke to tells me that one of the main reasons for this is, for China's silence, Sri Lanka's recent trend of leaning towards the West. If you look at certain steps taken by Finance Minister Basil Rajapaksa in the recent past, like the ad hoc attempt to give the Yugadanavi power plant contract to a US firm, now the allegiance to go to Western nations to get support for our financial crisis, and also more so or less seeking help only from India, has kind of put a wrench in the relations with Asia's big brother. Also, the recent fertilizer matter, where we rejected Chinese fertilizer that was safe, but officials here magically found hazardous bacteria, which later disappeared under a Singaporean microscope, have indeed strained our relationship with this friendly nation. Then there's the issue where President Gotabaya Rajapaksa has not yet visited China since his inauguration as president. He did go to India first, but has yet to visit China despite an active invitation by the Chinese president for a state visit. What puzzles me is why we didn't go to China to ask for this support in solving our dollar crisis before going to the IMF.
Former President Mahinda Rajapaksa's government, China was our strongest ally. As a result, by now, China is the biggest contributor to the Sri Lankan aid. Our relationship has is in a kind of a trouble at this moment. We must admit that. There are several reasons. You know, it is customary that a head of state of Sri Lanka first visit India, soon thereafter he or she goes to China. For last 2.5 years, he failed to visit China despite there is a pending invitation from Chinese president. Secondly, as you know, they secured this FSRU and gas supply project to power plants in Sri Lanka. It was secured by a Chinese company going through a competitive bidding process. The government decided to ignore that competitive bidding process and to offer this to New Fortress Energy, which is a company which did not participate in this process. Thirdly, there were three power plants to be installed in three islands in Northern. So again, ADB funded project, competitive bidding process was followed, and a Chinese company secured the all three power plants. And no Indian company participated in the bidding process, but once they realized that Chinese company has secured all three power plants, they offered a 75% grant and 25% loan to install and establish those power plants there. So China is again upset as a result. Fourthly, you know, the famous, infamous organic fertilizer ship issue.
Yes.
Sri Lanka filed a case against a company which brought a lot of publicity in the world media, and company got distributed as a result, is their main allegation. Fifthly, as you may have heard, there were certain issues raised by China about corruption involved in offering subcontracts in that phase. I can't remember exactly what that phase was. So because of these five reasons, Sri Lanka-China relationship is not at its best.
Now, China is one of the biggest single nations that has contributed in a big way to Sri Lanka's economic story. However, whilst we are looking for new export markets, China's market is something we barely manage to capitalize on. Now, there's an FTA in the discussion, but this is something Sri Lanka certainly can gain a lot and would help us to not purely depend on matters like the GSP Plus scheme, where the EU is trying to push their political agenda through. So it doesn't seem like it would be in our best interest to move away from China.
You mentioned about China. I think you're right. We seem to be drifting away from China. It's not a wise thing. It's not a wise thing. We should be keeping our cards, playing our cards in a balanced way. But this is again politics. It's seemingly, if you're playing that politics, we're going to get hammered in the worst scenario.
Well, joining me now is our own Dhanidhuitanamasam, who's at the data wall, and he's going to take a closer look at what opportunities lies in China for Sri Lanka. Dhanidhu, what do you got for us tonight?
Yes, Mahesh, something we're going to try and look within this segment is the exact volume, the magnitude of the Chinese market, and what exactly we as Sri Lankans could really focus on when looking at this huge market. Now, this is a look at what the import value of China is. Now, since China is a production hub, a manufacturing hub that is well known to the entire world, over 2 trillion imports happening within China. Now, that is the US dollar value of the amount of imports that are coming in to the country. If we take that same thought process forward, what exactly does Sri Lanka contribute in this entire mix? 3.5 billion as of year 2020. Now this, in comparison to 2 trillion, quite a small number, but you see the potential, the magnitude that we can reach out to. If we take that same thought process forward, we look at what exactly is China importing. Now, as I started with as we started this segment, it is a manufacturing hub, high-end products that are coming out of China, quality assurance, a lot of things that are happening. Majority of this, over 500 billion US dollars spent on electrical and electronic equipment. This primarily is from nations such as South Korea, nations such as Japan. Now, this is because of the sole purpose of value addition. Now, bringing in these products, making better products within that one country. Something I want to take your attention to is pharmaceuticals, rubber and fish. Areas that Sri Lanka could really focus on. Pharmaceuticals amounted to over 34 billion, rubber amounted to over 16 billion, and fish and aquatics amounted to over 12 billion. Certain areas that even Sri Lanka could go for a monopoly over. Certain things that our export managers, people that are really trying to export into this Chinese market, should really focus on. Over to you, Mahesh.
I hope our business community indeed look at those kinds of data and actually take initiative to get into this market, which we have barely scratched. Dhanidhuitanamasam at the data wall. Thank you very much. Let's get more context. Joining me now is the Sri Lankan ambassador in China, Dr. Palitakona from Beijing. Thank you very much, ambassador. Good to see you. Well, so the whole world knows Sri Lanka is undergoing an economic crisis. In the past, we've seen that when Sri Lanka is experiencing any type of crisis, China is always there to help. But this time around, there seems to be a bit of a lackluster from China's side. Is this silence attributing to the westernized economic approach the current finance minister is opting for?
Thank you for that very important question, Mahesh. I don't believe that China has changed its approach at all. They are engaged with Sri Lanka. We talk to them all the time in Beijing. What you see as a lackluster approach might be the result of a very mature economy taking its time to respond to Sri Lanka's needs. China has responded very positively to almost every one of our requests so far. But China is an economy that takes its time to respond. It's a very mature economy. It's like any other Western economy. When you make a request, you don't have a response immediately. It's unlikely. And China is the same. Processes are going through. We have asked for assistance with our imports. We have asked for assistance with our repayments. We know that. And I, as the ambassador and this mission, knows that the Chinese authorities are going through their internal processes to respond to us. I'm certain that at the end of the day, there will be a positive response. China has always stood by us through thick and thin when others were not standing by us. I'm certain that at this stage also, China will help us out. But again, you have to remember that it's not only China that has to come to the party. We also have to do certain things to help ourselves. For example, we need to make a concerted effort to improve our exports, especially to the Chinese market, which is everybody else's most lucrative market. Sri Lanka needs to do much more, and the initiatives have to come from Sri Lanka. We have suggested many initiatives to Colombo, including the conclusion of a free trade agreement, or at least starting negotiations on one. Let's hope that we will do our part while the Chinese will do their part. And it takes time in their own way.
True indeed. Now, we recently saw a currency swap and several loans with China. Do you think if Sri Lanka makes a plea, we can actually get a bailout from China?
I think a bailout is a wrong expression to use in this context. Sri Lanka is going through a difficult period. They've asked for a currency swap and it has been made available. They've asked China to provide us with credit facilities for importing Chinese raw material for our garments industry. And perhaps we may be able to use a credit facility for some of our other industries also. China, I know they are now considering these two requests at the highest levels. I'm certain that sooner than later, China will comply with our requests, because everyone knows that Sri Lanka is in this dire situation mostly due to circumstances beyond its control. And also you have to remember that the world is going through a difficult situation. In Australia yesterday, petrol was selling at $2 a liter. In America, a couple of days ago, petrol was selling at $6.45 a gallon. So it's not only Sri Lanka that is facing these difficulties. And there are supply chain problems in the US also, in the richest country in the world. So poor little Sri Lanka is having its own share of pain. And of course, I have to say that this share of pain is accentuated, magnified due to current circumstances. So I'm certain that China understands this, and China has always come to our assistance in the past. During the war, it was China that stood by us during a very difficult period. Then again, during the pandemic, China gave us 26 million doses of vaccine, three of which were a gift to Sri Lanka. So, and the relationship is a long-standing relationship. The political relationship is close and warm at the moment. I do not think that we need to have any doubts about our bilateral relationship. It's in very good hands at present.
To Ambassador, very quickly, President Gotabaya Rajapakse is yet to visit China. Why do you think there is a delay, and is that ever going to happen anytime soon?
I know that our president, President Rajapakse, Gotabaya Rajapakse, is scheduled to visit China. And the Chinese have said that it will happen as soon as the pandemic-related restrictions are relaxed. At present, a visit will not produce the results that both sides want to achieve from such a visit. It would be limited to the capital of China, and then that's it. I personally think that in order to create a high degree of awareness of Sri Lanka, of what Sri Lanka can export to China, and the need for Chinese investments in Sri Lanka, the president may have to visit more than the capital. He'll have to visit the industries, the agricultural zones. Remember that China has eliminated poverty completely. This is the one country in the world that has done that. And there are things that we can learn from what the Chinese achieved in such a short period. So personally, I think a visit has to be properly orchestrated so that the president will have the opportunity to see as much as possible during a state visit of that nature. To do that, I think it is necessary that the pandemic-related travel restrictions are relaxed. And we were hoping that the travel restrictions will be relaxed in the coming weeks, coming months, but there has been a spurt of infections in this country. I think this might result in any plans to invite an important foreign leader like President Gotabaya Rajapaksa. The plans may be modified as a result of this current situation in this country. So I have no doubts about that. The president will visit China, and it will happen sooner than later.
True, indeed. I would really like to talk more, but we're running out of time, Ambassador. Thank you very much. Sri Lankan Ambassador to China, Dr. Palithakona, thank you very much for speaking to me on State of the Nation. Well, to wrap up tonight's program, Sri Lanka is a nation that has undergone many challenges in the past. But at the same time, we also have a problem with short-term memory. At this time when we all need to rally around a single flag, a single goal to work hard to get out of this crisis, we need to be prudent and mindful not to fall for the opportunistic people who's out there trying to milk the situation for their personal gain. Sri Lankan has fallen many times, and just like that, Sri Lankans have got up many times as well. So yes, we've fallen today. But rest assured and make no mistake, we will rise again. Considering all that, the state of our nation is concerning tonight, but healing. So let's work together to get this nation right back on track. Well, that's all the time we have for you tonight. If you couldn't catch this program live, please watch it on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/otherderanaenglish. I'm Mahieash Johnney. Remember to stay positive and test negative. I'll see you soon. Good night. Your book begins, the rest is still unwritten. Staring at the blank page before you. Open up the dirty window. Let the sun illuminate the words that you cannot find. Reaching for something in the distance. So close you can almost taste it. Your inhibitions. Feel the rain on your